Shankara has a deceptive nature. Deceptive nature. It can deceive our eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind. Let us take some example. When you want to create a movie, you bring various places and make it appear to be very, very real. If it doesn't show real, the movie editors would say, this is weak, this is not good, this is not realistic. This doesn't give appearance of reality. So you have to make more and more deceptive things to make it. And so they edit and re-edit it until they are very pleased that they can arouse your greed, arouse your hatred, arouse your delusion, and deceive your eyes. And when all this come together, then the editor would say, this is a very good movie. For instance, there will be a big fire burning cars, and car is toppling down. A driver dies right on the spot. There's a lot of blood. Car is total and so forth. What they use is a toy car and various kind of color, red color, and the toy little dolls, like little toys, all they put together. And when the spectator look at it, they say, this is a wonderful, this is a terrible accident. And you can see the police coming and arresting, and you know, ambulance coming. All these are real toys. I remember all long ago, many, you are very familiar with seeing movies, and you know, I have seen them doing it. They take one picture from there, one picture from there. In one movie I saw when I was in India, my friends were making a movie, and I saw how hard they work to get all these little pieces here and there and put in together, finally to give you a very thrilling, exciting movie. And all these things that they did put together are called sankhara. Sankhara. When you cook food in the kitchen, and when you bring it to the table, you make it presentable, look attractive. In Pali, it's called sankhatiyo. Sankhatiyo. That is added more sankhara, decorations. When you have a party and so forth, you cook very good food, but it has to be put on the table and make it look very attractive and presentable. All this, you do additional things for that food. Similarly, our bodies, we put on all kind of things, decorations, and then all these put together, and then we make the body presentable, acceptable. All these are called sankharas. And therefore, sankhara is very big, wide term. So Buddha put these sankharas, the whole five aggregates are called, in short, sankharas. Although one of them is sankhara, but all of them together is called sankhara. And that is why Sankhara in the five aggregate sankharis, rupa, vedana, sanya, sankhara, vijnana. That sankhara is compared to banana tree, plant, banana tree. Banana tree appears from outside a tree with some hard wood, a core in it. But when you keep peeling off its outer layers, the skin, eventually you don't find any hard core, hard wood in it. Sankharas are like that, always deceive us. They appear to be very real, but in reality, inside, the truth is covered by layers of various things. And those covering, deceiving factors together called sankhara. And that is why it is very difficult to translate into one particular language, even Sinhalese, any language. It is difficult, except we translate them into various languages and explain what sankhara is. And therefore, no matter how hard we try to explain, until we think very carefully and we meditate, we don't understand what sankharas are. So, I mentioned yesterday the kind of sankharas, bodily sankhara, that is, inhaling and exhaling, bodily sankhara, or body conditioner. Then verbal sankhara, or word conditioner, and mental sankhara, or mind conditioner. So, Buddha said, these sankharas themselves are suffering. As long as we have sankharas, our suffering will not come to an end. Sankhara is not that very simple thing. Why it is called sankhara? Sankatang abhisankaroti iti sankhara. Sankhata, I mentioned yesterday, what is sankhata? What is sankhara? Sankhata is the conditioned, and sankhara is conditioner. Sankatang abhisankaroti. Sankati is, the body is sankata. Body is conditioned. Abhisankaroti is repairing, preparing, and making additional reconditioning. And what we do to recondition the conditioned is called sankhara. Using various things to recondition what is already conditioned. The body is conditioned by previous sankhara, and now we recondition it by new sankharas, new things. Therefore, it is called sankhata sankhara. And Buddha said, kinchi bhikkhave sankhatam sankaranti iti abhisankaroti iti rupang rupattha sankhatam abhisankaroti. The form is reconditioned to be a form. So that is to make it alive, to continue its functions. We always recondition this body. primary reconditioner is the breath, and secondary reconditioners are food, medicine, protein, vitamin and mineral. All other things that we put to this body are sankharas, which condition this body. And therefore, sankatang abhisankaroti. The conditioned is conditioned by other conditioners. So this we have to understand very clearly before we proceed with the rest of the discussion. And at the end of this first part, that is our meditation, after that I will explain it even more in detail. Now let us begin our metta. Okay. Okay, can you see this metta recitals? I hope you all can see. Let me begin. May all beings be happy and secure. May all beings have happy minds, whatever living beings there may be, without exception, weak or strong, long, large, medium, short, subtle or gross, visible or invisible, living near or far, born or coming to birth, may all beings have happy minds. Let no one deceive another, nor despise anyone anywhere, neither from anger nor ill will, should anyone wish harm to another. As a mother would risk her own life to protect her only child, even so towards all living beings, one should cultivate a boundless heart. One should cultivate for all the world a heart of boundless loving friendliness, above, below, and all around, unobstructed, without hate or resentment, whether standing, walking, sitting, lying down, or whenever awake. One should develop this mindfulness. This is called divinely dwelling here, not falling into erroneous views, but virtuous and endowed with vision. Removing desires for sensual pleasures, one comes never again to birth in the womb. Now with this metta thought, let us begin our practice. Friends, once again, we must wish all those who are affected by this virus be free from them and liberate them from their pain and suffering. Now, almost 55, close to 56,000 people are dead in the United States, and so many others have died in many other countries. And we want to share our metta or loving friendliness with their relatives, friends, dependents, and those who are living with this virus. We want to send our metta, wishing them to recover very quickly and return to normal life. And those who are supporting, we have come to know through media that those who have been helping them like doctors, nurses, their helpers, also are now affected by this virus. They got this virus from their patients, and therefore their heart is very wonderful, noble. They have been taking risks to help these people, and eventually they themselves got this virus. And this virus doesn't spare anybody. Whoever is exposed, get it. And therefore, we want to wish all of them, may they all be protected, find various means and sources to safeguard themselves, protect themselves, and may all the helpers, doctors, nurses, and others who help them, and those who provide other necessities like face masks, gloves, and clothing, and all this for them to use for their own protection, and those who are providing them, and those who are financing, those who use their time, energy, skill to bring up something, like those who do research to find some vaccine, and all of them be protected. May they return if they have any virus to normal health and live long in very good health for their benefit and for the benefit of everybody else. This is a everyday metta wish, loving friendliness wish. With this wish, we begin the rest of our practice, and we pay total, undivided, mindful attention to our breathing, noticing inhaling as inhaling, exhaling as exhaling, paying attention to the beginning, middle, and end of inhaling and exhaling. When we breathe in, we may notice our lungs are filling, and then our lungs are expanding, and we also notice the rising and falling of our abdomens, and also we feel the breath touching the rims of our nostrils. All these variations are there, and whoever is comfortable with whatever of this, whichever of these you are comfortable with, pay attention to there, keep the mind there, without using words, concept, ideas, or thinking of the past, future. Just pay total mindful attention to your breath. As you do that, your body relaxes, breath relaxes, mind relaxes, and then at the same time, you feel the feeling of inhaling. When the body is relaxed, you feel relaxed feeling. When your mind is relaxed, you feel relaxed feeling. When the breath is relaxed, you feel relaxed feeling. And they all change as we breathe in and breathe out. What arises when we breathe passes away when we breathe out. What arises when we breathe out passes away when we breathe in. This is the nature, the truth. Only when we pay attention can we notice them happening. Otherwise, they just happen without our awareness, and we don't gain any insight and understanding. Whenever we pay attention, mindful attention, pure, clean attention without greed, hatred or delusion, we can notice all these tiny little changes taking place in our body, breath and the mind. And then our hindrances will subside, greed, resentment or anger, restlessness and worry, sleepiness and drowsiness and doubt. They all naturally fade away. They cannot stay in our very clear, pure, relaxed state of mind. They leave. As they leave the mind, we gain the awareness of letting them go, letting whatever greed, delusion, anger, and so forth, let them go, disappear. And then that is followed by the sense of real deep metta, loving friendliness, which leads to compassion. When these three stages or three moments arise, letting go, metta, loving friendliness and compassion, there arises a moment of joy, happiness by letting them go, by not having them in our mind. We become very delightful, joy, and then gains degree of happiness that makes the mind and body very calm, relaxed and peaceful and lead to concentration. When we gain concentration, our awareness of the subtlest change becomes very clear. Otherwise, they are not visible or discernible to us. With this, we want to continue this sitting meditation.
दुःखपत्था च निर्दुःखा भयपत्था च निर्भया शोकपत्था च निःशोका हन्तु सर्वे पिपानिनो. May the suffering be free from suffering. May the fear-struck be free from fear. May the grieving be free from grief. So too may all beings be. Once again, friends, this is a very earnest wish. We all make this wish together as one unit, one mind, one human beings. We make this wish. Since we did some very few minutes, very good meditation, cleaning our mind, removing hindrances, and this is a very good moment when the mind is very fresh, clean and pure, without greed, hatred and delusion, with the state of mind, we can wish them to be free from pain, suffering, afflictions, and return to their normal life and live long in good health. Now I want to continue this talk on dependent origination. The sankharas, Buddha called, I mentioned yesterday, there are kaya sankhara, vachi sankhara, and chit sankhara. body conditioner, word conditioner, and mind conditioner. Among word conditioners, I mentioned there are six conditioners, three unwholesome, three wholesome. Three unwholesome conditioners are greed, hatred, and delusion. Three wholesome conditioners are non-greed, non-hatred, non-delusion. In the Noble Eightfold Path, these six are called sankappa, meaning thought. In this explanation, they are called vitakka. We said vitakka, vichara, a word conditioner. And these are the ones that are categorized as kamma. The bodily conditioners are not listed as kamma. Mind conditioners are not listed as kamma, but the word conditioners are mentioned or categorized as kamma, where there are thought, thinking. And that is why Buddha said this very famous statement he made, Chetanaham bhikkave kammam vadami. Chetana means thought, thinking. What do we think? We think with either greed, hatred, or delusion, or without greed, without hatred, or without delusion. And these are categorized as wholesome kammas and unwholesome kammas. The kammas that we commit with greed, hatred, and delusion are called unwholesome kammas. The kammas we committed without greed, hatred, and delusion are called wholesome kammas. Now, unwholesome kammas are explained as three physical kammas, four verbal kammas, and three again mental kammas. Three physical kammas are killing, stealing, and sexual misconduct. Four unwholesome mental kammas are telling lies, slanderous talk, talk with hatred, and talk with delusion. They can be telling lies, then slanderous talk, harsh speech, and gossip. They are called unwholesome verbal kammas. Four. And there are three mental unwholesome kammas. They are called covetousness, hatred, and wrong view. Abhijja, vyapada, michyati. Abhijja is the Pali word. Don't confuse abhijja with avijja. Avijja is ignorance. Abhijja means covetousness, greedy for others' things, others' properties, others, whatever belongs to others, and that is covetousness. So, on the wholesome side, we have wholesome non-greed, non-hatred, non-delusion, commerce. They also are three verbal, three physical, four verbal, and three mental. Three physical are abstaining from killing, abstaining from stealing, abstaining from sensual misconduct. When we say abstaining, this also implies something positive. For instance, when we abstain from killing, we practice giving life to others, supporting others to live, making their lives comfortable and healthy. That is the positive side. Abstaining is negative side. Similarly, not stealing is negative side. We don't steal. When we do not steal, we protect others by thoughts, words, and deeds, protect their properties, protect their lives. And then killing, stealing, and non-sensual misconduct, abstaining from committing sensual misconduct. Sensual misconduct means not abusing our senses. Instead, we use them correctly, rightly, our eyes, ears, tongue, body, and mind. We use meaningfully and to reduce our greed, hatred, and delusion. We use this aspect of our life, not our senses. We use our senses. That is abstaining from sensual misconduct. Then abstaining from four words, meaning not telling lies, meaning telling the truth. Not a slanderous talk, meaning we speak cordial, friendly words. And then instead of harsh words, we speak friendly words. Then instead of gossip, we speak something meaningful, talk about the Dhamma, something related to even talking about our jobs, how to do it properly, how to do the job without hurting, how to find the right job, and so forth, how to work with others in a very friendly way, and so forth. We can talk even about the job without gossiping and just wasting time. Then the last three are mental. Instead of abhijja, intense greed or covetousness, we practice generosity, dana, offering, giving away, giving things to anyone, even animals, anyone without any distinction or discrimination. Then vyapada, instead of anger, we cultivate loving friendliness. Practicing loving friendliness, practicing metta, is a wholesome, meritorious deed. Then last is instead of wrong view, we develop right view or right understanding. The number one in the Noble Eightfold Path, and the number one right understanding we use to get rid of our ignorance. So these are called wholesome karmas. And therefore, unwholesome karmas are committed by verbal conditioners. Wholesome karmas also committed by verbal conditioners. They are called
अभिसंकार, अभिसंकार पुण्य अभिसंकार, अपुण्य अभिसंकार, अनैन्य अभिसंकार. पुण्य अभिसंकार इज, अभिसंकार मीन्स कलेक्टिंग, एक्यूमुलेटिंग, बिल्डिंग अप, होल्डिंग, दैट इज अभिसंकार. ओ एज वी अर्लियर मेंशन संकतं अभिसंकरोति इति, रीकंडीशनिंग. The we use the word to recondition our word. For instance, when we have a wholesome thought, we recondition the wholesome thought by doing more wholesome thought. That is also called sankata abhisankara. Sankata is thought, and sankata we divide into two, wholesome and unwholesome. When we have wholesome thought like non-greed, non-hatred, non-delusion, we support them, multiply them, develop them. That supporting, multiplying, developing, practicing again and again, repeating is called conditioning. So we condition the wholesome word, wholesome thought, to do more wholesome thought, to develop more wholesome thought. We develop wholesome habit to improve our wholesome speech. When we speak friendly way, we enjoy that. We make others happy, and we repeat it again and again. That is reconditioning. So we recondition our thought, our habit, wholesome habit, good thought, good word, and they are called sankara, abhisankara. Reconditioning our thought. Similarly, compassion, metta, and so on, we repeat them again and again. By repeating them, the repetition, or sometimes called bhavana. Bhavana means repeating. Bhavana is cultivating. Cultivating wholesome mental state. When we hear the word cultivation, cultivation, when you do cultivation, you have to prepare the land, removing rocks and weed and so on. You level it, put fertilizer, and then plant seed. Similarly, when we cultivate our mind, which is called meditation, we remove unwholesome state, underlying tendencies, anusayas, fetters, hindrances. We remove them and cultivate wholesome states. And that is therefore called cultivation or meditation. In the meditation, it is not just sitting in one place, focusing mind on the breath, but using the breath, we practice sitting meditation. Any other time, walking, lying down and talking or so forth, we talk very mindfully to develop our mind. That all is called bhavana, and that bhavana is sankara. What sankara? Wholesome sankara. And therefore, there are three kinds of sankaras. We have, this is a very big subject. We will talk more about it. Three kinds of sankaras. Unwholesome. Unwholesome sankaras are committed by greed, hatred, and delusion. When we commit something with greed, it is just like planting a seed. Suppose there is a seed which is not spoiled, not broken, and in good condition, it can sprout easily. And we prepare the land, and the land also is prepared with greed. What is that land? Is kamma. The kamma itself is called a land, where the karma seed planted. That is why Buddha said, Kammam Kettam Vijnanam Bijam. Vijnana, we add our karma seed to Vijnana, and then it will plant in the soil of karma. So when we commit that kind of karma, the seed we plant, and when we plant the seed there, that will grow into expected crops, expected plants or trees and vine or whatever. But similarly, if we do something with hatred, we plant the seed and it will grow. When we plant the seed with ignorance, delusion, confusion, then this we plant the seed of confusion. But when we cultivate, when we prepare the land and cultivate the seed of non-greed, this is the beauty. When we practice repeatedly commit non-greed karma or karma without greed, then when that karma is complete, greed will completely disappear. When we practice karma with non-greed, without greed, when that karma ends, greed will completely disappear. When you commit karma with greed, greed will never come to an end. When we do karma without greed, then one day greed will completely vanish, disappear. Similarly, when you commit a karma without hatred, like practicing loving friendliness, when that loving friendliness karma ends, then hatred will completely end. If you commit something with confusion, delusion, and then when that karma comes to an end, confusion or delusion fades away. So these are the three roots of wholesome karmas, and those are the three roots of unwholesome karmas. Therefore, the karma is divided into punya abhisankara, apunya abhisankara. Punya abhisankara brings, punya means that which we commit to do to make us happy. The very meaning of the word punya is making happy. So when we do punya, wholesome karma, then that wholesome karma will bring happiness. That is called punya abhisankara, collecting abhisankara, collecting, collecting, collecting. Apunya abhisankara means collecting unwholesome karmas, committing with greed, hatred, and delusion. And that will produce unwholesome, woeful, painful results. Then, so these are two categories, wholesome karmas, unwholesome karmas, and there is another category of karma called anenyabhisankara. Anenyabhisankara means collecting, preparing, reconditioning the mind. That is called imperturbable karma. Anenya means imperturbable karma. What is imperturbable karma? Imperturbable karma is attaining jhanas. There are 8 jhanas, 4 material, 4 immaterial. When you practice that and attain that state of concentration, the mind is unshakable. Punya is unshakable. Therefore, they are called unshakable karma. And there are three karmas: home, unwholesome, and imperturbable. And three wholesome roots, three unwholesome roots of committing these karmas. I think, friends, as I said, this is a big subject. I will explain all these things in more detail and make it as simple as possible. for us to understand how dependent origination works. Now, I mentioned these three because these are all sankharas. Number two, independent origination formula, number two is sankhara. Sankharas are committed in the darkness of ignorance. When the darkness of ignorance is no longer, we don't commit sankharas. And this is, I explain even in more details, but just to introduce this part, this subject, I mention only this much today. And I hope we can continue this tomorrow at 10 o'clock. And I hope you all come and enjoy this explanation of dependent origination. And once again, I want to conclude this little session on meditation and Dhamma talk, wishing once again all those who are in suffering, pain, affected by this virus, and may they all recover, and may all those who are suffering from grief of losing their relatives, friends, and so on, we want to, our heart goes to them, and we want to wish them solace, comfort, and peace by understanding Dhamma and meditating, and we share our metta with them for their own well-being and happiness. And also we want to wish again all those who are supporting them, doctors, nurses, medical professionals, scientists, chemists, physicists, who are helping in whatever way they can. And also I want to wish, or we also all want to wish, that may all the leaders who make decisions always be wise, to make wise and right decision to reduce this virus and wipe out from the earth. And with this metta wish, we want to conclude this morning session. And I hope we all keep this in mind and wish always peace and happiness for everybody. I want to thank you for participating in this and joining us. And see you tomorrow morning again.